Defence technology group Cohort says strong organic growth was boosted by first-time contributions from two acquisitions, MCL and J+S. Well, the firm posted a 40% rise in revenues to just shy of £100 million. The order book grew 63% and investors are to be rewarded with a 21% boost to the final payout, which takes the total dividend to 5p. Andrew Thomis is the chief executive. So, Andrew, with net cash of £19.7 million, will this be a war chest, as it were, to make further acquisitions?
Well, it was a pleasing year as far as cash is concerned. Cash generation was good, and I think we continue to see acquisitions as being a source of future value for investors. We have a good pipeline. We're continuing to look at both bolt-in and standalone acquisitions as new members of the group. Our intention is to continue that in parallel, though, with the progressive dividend policy that you've already made mention of, which has grown by around 20% a year over recent years. We'd like to continue growing that dividend too.
Well, in terms of the numbers and the dividend that we've been discussing, how likely is it that this can be duplicated, replicated, when I speak to you this time next year?
Well, of that £134 million order book, some £71 million is due to be run off as revenue in the course of the financial year ahead, 2015-16. And if you look at the external forecast, for instance, Investec, that means we've got about 66% of the revenue that they're forecasting already on order, which is a pleasing position. I think it's considerably better than the 54% or so we had at this time last year, and we were quite pleased with that. We do see some good opportunities for wins beyond that, particularly at SEA, where there are good submarine communications opportunities and opportunities for road flow wins in the UK and in export markets, and some good opportunities at SCS as well. So overall, I think there's no reason to think we can't make good progress in the year ahead and beyond.
In terms of new opportunities, I mean, you very deftly skirted around my question about acquisitions, but, you know, there aren't that many businesses out there left to purchase. So I'm thinking about where you could possibly cast your net. You know, would you look at non-European purchases to establish a global footprint?
Well, we do have an active process of monitoring and communicating with potential acquisition targets. And we don't limit ourselves to the UK by any means, although all of our current operations are based in the UK. I certainly wouldn't rule out the possibility of a European acquisition or perhaps further afield. So we don't want to limit ourselves in that way. What's more important is to find the right acquisitions. Although it's a core part of our strategy, it's not something that we wander into lightly, and we don't expect to see a machine-like stream of acquisitions. We're very keen to find the right ones, and what's important to us is the agility, flexibility, innovation that are the hallmarks of the kind of the businesses that are already in the group, as well as the potential for growth, access to growth markets, and of course operating in technology areas that are complementary to those of the group already.
So where are these growth markets? You talked about a good healthy pipeline in your order book. Your clients are based in which territories now?
Well, predominantly we are still a UK defence provider. About 70% of our output in the year just passed went to UK defence one way or another. It might be thought that that is a market subject to constriction as a result of public spending limits. Well, we still do see opportunities in UK defence. There is a strategic defence and security review which will be coming up in the autumn, and we wait to see the results of that with interest. But I still do expect to see opportunities for us in our core areas in the UK, which are submarines, intelligence systems, and information systems. Beyond the UK, we see opportunities in a number of different regions. We're already very active in Southeast Asia and in the Arabian Gulf, and there is certainly reason to expect that demand for defence and security equipment in those regions will continue to be high.
Now, briefly, Andrew, you talked about that review coming out in August there. Currently, what about, Dean, talk to me about the pressures within the UK defence market.
Well, Clearly, there is pressure on public spending generally, and defence has got no exemption for that. But government clearly recognises that there is pressure in the opposite direction too. We've all seen the reports about the need for 2% of GDP to be spent on defence within NATO. I'll be very interested to see the results of the Strategic Defence and Security Review, but I would be quite surprised if particularly those core areas from which Cohort tends to operate are squeezed significantly. And also, I understand that there is a commitment to increase the overall level of defence expenditure that goes on equipment by an above-inflation amount. So I am cautiously optimistic that we will see at least stability in UK defence going forward. And for a business like ours, inevitably there will be opportunity too.
Andrew Thomis, Chief Executive of Cohort, thank you very much indeed for joining us.
Thank you.